great pleasure to have her, talking about STM and tunneling and related things.
Okay,
thank
thanks.
You.
Well, it's a pleasure to be here, and thanks to Dan and Andre and all the people who worked hard to organize this. And I love Boulder so much that I confess I spent a long time in the mountains this weekend and a somewhat shorter time preparing this talk, but the bonus is that somewhere in this talk there will be a map of a route you can take if you happen to be around for one extra day at the end. So I'm going to talk about tunneling, scanning tunneling microscopy with a little bit of historical information just about tunneling more generally. And just to give an overview of the stuff that I do in my own lab, I do STM, and I also do force microscopy, and we've studied a bunch of materials ranging from topological to superconductivity to magnetic materials, quasi-one-dimensional materials, and charged density wave materials. But of course, this is a summer school about superconductivity, so I'm going to focus on visco and iron-based superconductors and nitrogen selenide. But today is primarily cuprates. Okay, so let's start with an STM. This is a picture of the STM that my first student, Ian, built. And the STM is basically, this whole thing is about 1¼ inches in diameter. And the whole crux of the STM is one sharp tip and one flat sample that you want to study. And just for practical reasons, sorry, I didn't realize I wasn't loud. Oh, it's your videoing, huh? Does that work okay? Okay, good. For practical reasons, we often, even though intuitively you might think of scanning a tip across a sample like this, for practical reasons, we often scan the tip across a sample like this, because once we get a nice sharp tip that we can tunnel from, we'd like to be able to remove and put in new samples from above. So geometrically, in our STM, our tip is pointed up, then our sample is pointed down. And what do? We have our flat sample that we want to study, and we approach the tip very close to the sample, and almost everything you see here is really just a motor. All of this bulk, what's the physics, the measurement is going on in this tiny nanoscale region right here where the tip approaches the sample, but all of this machinery that you see is really dedicated to approaching the tip to within a nanometer or so of the sample so that the measurement can take place. So this is a nanoscale stepper motor, and once we've approached the tip to within a few angstroms of the sample, then we apply a bias voltage to the sample, and with a tip held at virtual ground, and then a current is going to flow between the sample and the tip, and we effectively measure that current. So the measurement of an STM is a current. So how does that work? So here's a schematic of the tip density of states and the sample density of states. So energy is the vertical axis here, and if you take your head and you turn it to the right, then you see a plot of tip density of states as a function of energy, cutting off at the Fermi level, and some Fermi function which I've drawn in there. So these are filled states, these are empty states. And now if you turn your head to the left, you see the density of states of the sample, and this has some funky shape that we'd like to measure. And we typically choose our tip to be some boring metal that has a flat density of states at the Fermi level, and that will be obvious later why we do that. So if we have zero voltage applied between tip and sample, then their Fermi levels would coincide. But as soon as we apply some voltage V between the sample and the tip, then that raises the Fermi level of one with respect to the other. So for example, if we apply a negative voltage to the sample, then the electrons would like to leave the sample. So effectively, we raised the Fermi level of the sample above the tip here, and we'll get a tunneling current. And the tunneling current, qualitatively speaking, is going to be proportional to this integrated density of states here, which, because these are the states that are energetically allowed to tunnel into these now empty states in the tip here. And to quantify that a little bit, the sample tip tunneling current by Fermi's golden rule is going to be a product of the filled states available for tunneling from. So this is the density of filled states times the Fermi function here. And this is going to be multiplied by the number of empty states here available for tunneling too. So this here this equation is at a fixed energy E. So at a particular energy E, that's the tunneling current. And now in order to get the total tunneling current between here and here, what I need to do is integrate over the full ranges of energies available for tunneling. So here I've integrated from the essentially zero energy. I've offset the Fermi level with respect to, I've called the Fermi level zero here, and so the most negative energy is negative EF. So my total tunneling current is going to be the filled states for tunneling from times the empty states for tunneling to, and then there's a tiny contribution going the other direction. The exponential tail of this can tunnel into the exponential tail of those empty states here. And when I sum that all up, I get this sort of long, messy thing. But as you can really see by eye, it's going to simplify pretty well. Because if we assume that we're operating at low temperature, which typically we do to study a superconductor, then at low temperature, the Fermi function is almost an exact cutoff. So we can approximate the Fermi functions here by step functions at the Fermi level. So assuming t equals zero and approximating those Fermi functions as step functions, that messy sum simplifies out to this. And now if we assume that the tip density of states is flat here, which if we choose a material like tungsten or platinum iridium, it typically is, then the tip density of states, which is inside this integral, pops outside the integral, and we just have tip density of states at the Fermi level. And so the current flowing from here to here is, as we said qualitatively at the beginning, just equal to the integral of this area under the density of states curve. But we still have this matrix element here. And that matrix element, it turns out to a good approximation, is constant and can be taken outside of the integral. And we can estimate it just from WKB that the tunneling probability through a barrier, where the geometric distance of the barrier is S here, the tunneling probability will decay exponentially in that distance S. So it's e to the minus 2 times this gamma, and this gamma contains the tip sample distance S. It also contains the work function between the tip and the sample. But really, the important takeaway message from this is that the tunneling current is equal to the integral of the sample density of states over this energy range, which is set by the applied voltage, with an exponential decay due to the geometry of the system, due to how far the tip is away from the sample. And the details can be found here for anybody who wants to go look those up. So putting this all together, here's our STM again. And so far, I just talked about the energy axis. But the other piece of the STM, as I said, is a motor here. The motor allows us to approach the tip of the sample and control that S parameter. But it also allows us to scan the tip with respect to the sample and gives us 2 degrees of freedom geometrically in X and Y. So now with an STM, we can take measurements in real space, X and Y, and by varying the tip sample voltage, we have an energy degree of freedom here. So we essentially can get a three-dimensional data set. And we can slice that up in a couple of different ways. One way is to park the tip at a single location and take a density of state spectrum. So here's the density of states of BISCO. Nice gap with sharp coherence peaks around the Fermi level. Or we can fix the tip sample voltage and scan back and forth in space and produce a map of the density of states at a particular energy. And let me go back here to this diagram one more time just to point out that the total tunneling current that we measure is equal to this integral of the density of states in this regime here. But we can for the experimentalists here, we can use a lock-in amplifier to essentially take a derivative of this integral. And when we take a derivative of the integral, we're taking a dI dV measurement, and that dI dV becomes equal to the density of states at a particular energy slice. Yeah.
Jenny, when you scan over the surface, how can you be sure that the distance between your tip and the sample doesn't change?
That is an excellent question, and I actually saved that slide as a subtlety at the end. And don't worry, there's a million slides here, but you're not all. Don't panic. You don't have to panic because I'm panicking already. No. Okay. So this is a notorious problem with STM. How do we get the tip sample distance fixed? And it's actually, I think, really the biggest drawback of STM is that we don't have a perfect way to set the tip sample distance. And so in practice, what we do is we choose a tunneling current set point. So we say, I would like 100 picoamps between the tip and the sample, and we choose a voltage. And so by choosing this set point, and this set voltage, then allowing the piezo that controls that distance to vary until it fixes the current at that set point, what we're effectively doing is fixing the integral of the density of states. This is the density of states of the sample here. So essentially, if we fix the current between tip and sample depends on the distance, and it depends on the density of states, and the integrated density of states depends on the set point voltage. So by fixing this and varying z, we're choosing that distance. But now the problem is that we have to choose that distance independently at every single location in space, because we can never assume that our sample is perfectly flat, and in any case, our sample has atomic corrugations. So everywhere we go in space, we have to re-choose this z set point. And this z set point, as we can see from this equation, is always going to depend on the integral of the density of states. So the in the end, the current that we measure, which depends on this set point, if we just divide this out of the equation, we see that the current that we measure depends on the density of states that we want, and also the integral of the density of states up to the set point we chose. And so in the end, this is what we measure. dI dV is our chosen set current. That's no problem because that's constant, but it also depends on this integral, which depends on R. So this is the raw density of states that we want, and we can never get it without a denominator that's equal to the integral of the density of states. So practically speaking, what we like to do is choose VSET to be quite large. We hope that we can choose VSET to be so far away from any energy features of the problem that it's relatively homogeneous. And if it's relatively homogeneous, then we can ignore this. But in practice, in cuprates, there's stuff going on off to, you know, way big energy ranges. And so you can't do a perfect job of choosing VSET to be large enough. So another way that people deal with this is they say, well, superconductors should be particle hole symmetric, so let's just measure the tunneling current at positive energy and measure it at negative energy and divide the one by the other. If we divide the one by the other, then this whole term pops out, and we end up with this quantity called Z, which was first proposed by Phil Anderson and utilized by the Davis group. And so, again, it's not a perfect measure of density of states because now you're entangling the positive energy and the negative energy, but at least you've gotten rid of this entire integral there. So that was a long answer to that question. And in practice, I think the main reason that this is problematic is if you have some periodic modulation in space, you can entangle the energy of that modulation. It would be very hard to tell what energy that modulation is at.
So does this mean that, say, inhomogeneity in spectral features affects how you interpret the topography measured in STM?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. But it is logarithmically coupled into the topography because the topography is a measure of a contour of constant tunneling current. And since the tunneling current depends exponentially on the distance, but only linearly on the density of states, it's not quite as bad as you might initially think. Were there further follow-up questions on that? So some advantages of STM are that we can get filled and empty state information. We can apply a positive or negative bias between the tip and the sample, and therefore we can tunnel from the tip to the sample or from the sample to the tip, so we can get filled and empty states. Since the STM is really small, and we don't need optical access or anything, it's relatively easier to get it cold. So the best STMs to date are in the tens of millikelvin, and that is the only limiting factor on the energy resolution. So microvolt energy resolution is possible. It also has no problem with magnetic fields. We can operate in high magnetic fields because the electrons don't have to go very far. They just have to cross a nanoscale tunnel junction. It can give atomic spatial resolution, and at the end I might talk about subatomic spatial resolution. And also, it can give us, surprisingly, it can give us momentum space resolution. So when you naively look at the geometry of this, it looks like we're collecting electrons from all different directions, and we'd be integrating over momentum space. But by some thoughtful analysis, we can get back momentum space information with nanoscale spatial resolution. So I'll come back to that. The disadvantages, of course, of STM are that it's a surface, completely surface-sensitive measurement. So it's sensitive only to that density of states right at the surface of the material, because that's the density of states that's decaying into the vacuum gap that we're actually tunneling into. And also, many materials are difficult to expose a clean surface. If you cleave them or otherwise scrape them or something, you'll end up with junk on the surface, or you'll end up with some kind of surface polarity or strange termination, which generates a reconstruction which is not representative of the bulk. So we have to be very careful in interpreting and choose materials which are likely to have a surface that is bulk-like. And because of this exponential dependence on the tip sample distance, the vibration sensitivity is pretty horrific. Most experiments are linearly sensitive to the environment, and STM is exponentially sensitive to noise in the environment. So we have to be really careful to shield from, say, like a spider who sneezes next door or something. Okay, so I really struggled to try to figure out how to organize this talk, this series of talk, to capture all of tunneling on superconductors in two lectures. So I finally kind of settled on this historical timeline, and what I'm going to do is pay homage to these first measurements in each of these categories, and then kind of use each of these as a starting point to move forward and talk about more recent measurements in that category. But for reasons of trying to organize the overall structure, the homage paying is not going to proceed in order. So here's your one ordered timeline, and now I'm going to kind of pick and choose from these menu items in random order, more based on the end point than on the starting point that you choose. So STM was not invented until 1982, and it garnered the Nobel Prize here shortly thereafter for Wenig and Rohrer at IBM. But even before scanning tunneling microscopy was invented, there were two really important tunneling measurements that took place. The first tunneling measurement of a superconducting gap in 1960 via a planar tunnel junction, and then a careful measurement in very similar geometry, another planar tunnel junction out to higher energies and with better resolution, was able to ascertain not just the superconducting gap, but also the bosons which were coupling into the electronic structure and ultimately giving rise to the superconducting gap. So then once STM was invented, we got spatial resolution, and here are some of the important milestones in STM. The first measurement of a charge density wave in a superconductor, or any material actually for that matter. Measurements of imaging of vortices in superconductors, imaging of single atom impurities in superconductors, and then the use of Fourier transform analysis to back out the band structure and momentum space gap symmetry from images, STM images, and then Tetsuo Hanaguri's work to apply magnetic field dependence to this technique and back out actually a phase-sensitive measurement of the superconducting gap in another cuprate, NACCOC. And finally, Michael Waller introduced an algorithm in 2010, which allows vision into sub-unit cell structure of the superconductor. So I will start at the beginning with a gap measurement. And the very first tunnel junction measurement of a superconducting gap took place GE in 1960 with an aluminum lead tunnel junction with an insulating aluminum oxide in the barrier. And by applying a field to suppress, so this whole measurement took place at 1.6 Kelvin above the TC of aluminum, so it was really a normal insulator superconductor tunnel junction, even though aluminum is a superconductor at 2 Kelvin. And then by applying a field to suppress superconductivity, and then removing the field to allow superconductivity here, and then dividing the results of the tunneling current, Ivar Giammer was able to measure the density of states of this lead superconductor and measure the superconducting gap of about 1.7 millielectron volts. So this was not the first measurement of a superconducting gap. The first measurement was actually a specific heat measurement, and then there were some optical absorption measurements. But this was only a few years after the first measurement, and it's in fact the simplest measurement, the simplest way to measure a superconducting gap. Yeah.
I came with this for the town anecdote here. So Ivan Gaber was my professor when I was an undergrad at RPI.
Oh.
And he told us a story how in the same set of measurements, they were also finding a lot of samples which they thought were short, which then later turned out to be the discovering Josephson effect.
Oh, okay. Thank you for that piece of history. Okay. And thank you for correcting my pronunciation of his name. Okay. So now, having paid homage to this first tunneling measurement of a superconducting gap, I'm going to move on to STM. And for STM, again, we have a very surface-sensitive measurement, and we need a clean, flat surface to tunnel into. And so everybody's favorite material for STM is BISCO, and Dan probably talked about this also, why ARPES likes BISCO. BISCO is a great superconductor. It's got a TC of 90 Kelvin, which is accessible, but it allows you to operate at effectively 0 Kelvin, well in the superconducting gap. But more importantly, BISCO, although it has this kind of heinous crystal structure, it has this glorious van der Waals bond between these two bismuth oxide mirror planes. So here's a photograph of the sample of BISCO. It's pretty flaky like graphite. What we do practically is we glue a little post to one side of the sample, and we glue the other side to our copper sample holder, and we stick the whole construction face down into our STM. At some point it goes through a spring-loaded whapper, which whaps off the stick and exposes a flat surface, which is then available for tunneling into. And this is pretty standard in other, okay, I said we, but STMs around the world, this is how they operate. And because it's cleaving in the van der Waals layer, there's no charge at the surface. There's no surface polarity, and so we expect the surface to be not reconstructed and to be pretty bulk-like. So here's an image of the surface of BISCO. There's this kind of overall modulation called the supermodulation, which is a little bit of a structural buckling that we don't worry about too much. It's there in the bulk of the sample too. But we're looking directly at this bismuth oxide layer. And the physics is going on in the copper oxide layer here.
Okay.
Yeah.
So is this modulation the superstructure called in the community?
It's called the supermodulation.
It's the same as the superstructure.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
And the picture that you show is a topography?
It's a topography of the surface.
Does it
yeah.
show up also in like a tensor space, this kind of modulation?
Very faintly, it does. I have a couple of hidden slides on that later, which I can show at that time, if you want me to. Yeah. It shows up faintly in the, I think the punchline is that it shows up in the density of states, and there was some work by the Davis group claiming that it was the modulations of the apical oxygen atom height, which was affecting the density of states. But I have become convinced through our own work that there were some hidden dopants in the material. And those dopants tend to correlate with the crests of the supermodulation, and it's probably the dopants that are controlling the structure rather than, the dopants that are controlling the density of states rather than the structure that's going to. So there's an extra step in that chain of causality. So here's a square which covers between four of these atoms that are sticking out the surface. So this is a bismuth oxide plaquette here on the surface. But immediately underneath that is a copper oxygen plaquette. So basically, everywhere we see a bismuth on the surface, we know that there's copper pretty much below it. And the great thing about having these extra protective layers here is that they're effectively insulating, or we hope that they don't, there's some evidence that they don't contribute tremendously to the density of states. And furthermore, they protect the dopants. So the copper oxygen plane gets its charge from interstitial oxygens sitting around here. And so if we were to just cleave directly on the copper oxygen plane, which you might initially think would be ideal, then we'd actually be in big trouble because we would have cleaved the dopants right away, and what we'd see on the surface would not be bulk-like. Whereas when we cleave in this beautiful van der Waals layer, then we can tunnel into this layer. These two layers act kind of like an extension of the vacuum gap, and they protect the dopants so that this first copper layer that we are tunneling into is like all of the bulk layers that we found. Does that make sense? Okay. So one of the, since we're in the gap section of the talk, and then we went from planar tunneling to STM, the first obvious thing to do is to measure and see if the gap itself has any spatial structure. And this was done, this experiment was led by Christine Lang in the Davis group at Berkeley 12 years ago, and she measured the, at every single point in space, she took a density of states spectrum. So, park the tip here, density of states. And each measurement takes a couple seconds. And this is something like 256 by 256 pixels. And so to take a spectrum of a couple seconds in an area that big, you're talking a several day measurement. So keeping the tip registered to the sample with this nanoscale, atomic scale resolution for a couple days is a challenge. And the total number of data points is well over a million. And at the end of the day, you have this three-dimensional data set, and you want to somehow display this three-dimensional data set. So at every point in space, you reduce this whole spectrum to a single piece of information, which is the distance between the coherence peaks, or twice the gap. And then you plot the gap as a function of space. So small gap is in red, large gap is in black, and these maps here show a tremendous inhomogeneity, factor of three inhomogeneity in the super, in what at that time was thought to be the superconducting gap, and now there's a little more understanding that there are probably two gaps in the system, the superconducting gap and the pseudo gap. But the dominant gap in the spectrum is varying by a factor of three on the, I don't have a scale bar here, shame on me. This is 60 nanometers from here to here. So it's varying on the 2 to 3 nanometer length scale in the material. So that was astonishing to find the superconducting gap, or find what was thought to be the superconducting gap varying on such a short length scale in the material, but it also suggests that there's kind of an opportunity here, because if there's some local variable which is controlling the gap by this huge swing in the material, then there's presumably something that can be optimized so that you could push larger fraction of the material in the direction that you would want to optimize superconductivity. So, Yeah.
If you cool down, if you raise the temperature and going down, do you see the same pattern or?
Yeah. I mean, of course, it's going to. Sorry. I'm trying to not cough in the microphone. And then I rung it instead. Yes, of course, at some temperature it will change. But if you go up to modest temperatures like room temperature, it will change. Yeah.
If you do the same experiment on a conventional superconductor, what would you see?
Totally constant, yeah. Yeah. Unless you have on a conventional superconductor, if you put a magnetic impurity there, then within a few angstroms of that magnetic impurity, you'll start to see modulations. But in you're not going to see spontaneous modulations. So I mean, a big difference, though, between BISCO and a conventional superconductor is that BISCO is not a stoichiometric material. And so the first obvious candidate that is controlling this gap locally is the oxygen dopants themselves, which are necessary to put BISCO into the superconducting state. Okay, so this gap mapping was done in much more detail by Kyle McElroy, who's on the faculty here. He followed the gap in homogeneity over a much wider range of doping and really showed that this nanoscale length scale persists over a wide range of doping, and the spectra vary hugely in the same field view of material. So again, this suggests an opportunity to look for a local variable and that might be interesting. And just to reinforce that idea that this is a worthy pursuit, there's this nice work by the Astati group. Ken Gulmas showed that not only does the gap width vary in space, but by following the gap at a particular location up in temperature, and this is a sample which has 65 Kelvin TC, so you can see 60 Kelvin, 64, 68, 72. So there's still some kind of gapping going on here, even above TC. and so what Ken Gomez and Ali Astani did is they plotted the temperature at which the gap itself disappeared. So not the width of the gap, but the closed temperature of the gap. And they can make a map of the temperature at which the gap closed, or in fact, they display it in the paper a little different way. They said at a particular temperature here above that TC, which regions are still gapped. So there's regions that are still gapped even above TC. And so this again kind of reinforces the importance of understanding what's going on locally, because if we can get a handle on that variable, maybe we could raise more of the sample to have a higher gap closing temperature. Or maybe the gap is actually, maybe the dominant gap is the pseudo gap, which is competing with superconductivity, and maybe we want to suppress it. But there's a tremendous amount of inhomogeneity, and you want to understand the root of the inhomogeneity. And this is a little phase diagram that they put together of TC of the material, and then the gap closure temperature. And this is showing the gap coverage here. So basically, you think of orange as being 50% of the material is still gapped. So 50% of the material is still showing gaps up to this very high temperatures here. Is that a preparing gap? Oh, sorry, I didn't see your hand.
No, don't worry. But if you repeat this measurement in a different time, you obtain the same region gap or not, or change?
So this is not my experiment, but I believe from talking to Ali that it's the same. So he's not going to very high temperatures here, and I believe that he sees no changes even going up to room temperature and back. But of course, at some point, you're going to get into a regime where oxygen's in the material. And I think that point is above room temperature.
Yeah, you said those higher temperatures are where the gap closed. Mm-hmm. Can you maybe distinguish between gap closing and gap filling?
So this paper didn't make a big distinction of that.
Okay.
He, practically speaking, defined T close as the point at which there's no longer a local maximum on the right side of the gap. So it was a purely practical distinction. But if you follow a series of these images, you can see these puddles shrinking and the colors changing. So there's some filling going on as well. And he didn't put big effort into disentangling filling versus closing. I mean, you've done a much more careful job of that, I think.
Yeah, different spectroscopy.
Yeah.
Just to clarify the how the an ARPA's spot size is it like how big compared to that field of view?
Yeah. Oh, again, shame on me. I don't have a scale bar. I'm sorry. Well, I know
monstrous.
This is probably about 40 nanometers. I'm just guessing here. And you said ARPA's is going towards 10 nanometer length scale or something.
Oh, but no measurements. I mean, ones that have been measured so far are 500 microns or something like that. So totally different scale.
Claim 100 down to 100 microns?
Yeah, but it's still the same on this scale.
Right, okay.
It's infinite on this
scale.
So
ARPAS is averaging over all of this. So this motivates the search for the hidden variable, which I don't mean in a quantum mechanical sense, I mean it just in a practical sense. but there's something locally that's going on. The most obvious thing is oxygen dopa chemistry. And again, Kyle McElroy was really the first to break open this problem, and he was able to introduce individual oxygen dopas in VSCO, which is a kind of a tour de force experimentally because he had to apply a rather large voltage between tip and sample. And VSCO, if you've ever had a chance to play with it, is a really flaky material. So you apply a large voltage, and that's a large force on this flaky material, and you can kind of self-cleave the material right under the tip, which is bad. So through some finesse, he was able to go to these voltages where the oxygen atoms have local resonances, and then place all these white dots on the gap map to try to find the correlation between the oxygens and the gap map. And the funny thing is, or the conclusion of the paper, which I now find to be very confusing, is that there were strong correlations between the oxygen dopants and the gap. And so what is that, why is that strange? Well, here's a plot that Dan showed in his talk, which you've probably seen many times by now, showing that there are actually two energy scales in the system. There's a superconducting energy scale, and there's the pseudogap energy scale. And while the early measurements, STM measurements, looked at this gap here and assumed that it was a superconducting gap, in fact, it follows this pseudogap line here. And so it's probably representative of the pseudogap, not the superconducting gap. So all of these gap maps that you see are actually, you can think of them as pseudogap maps. Now, the pseudogap is monotonically decreasing when doping. So that means that as you increase, we are increasing the doping here, and we are decreasing the gap values. However, locally, what was found was that these oxygen dopants correlate with larger gap. So here we're going with increasing dopants, and the global gap is getting smaller. But the local correlation shows that the local gap is getting bigger around the oxygen atoms. So that's very strange. So that's kind of saying that locally, within each sample, the slope of gap versus doping is going in the wrong direction. Yeah.
Yeah, so in the graph it says that you define the superconducting gap just as 5 times K times DC. Is that?
This is a plot from the review paper,
right.
And it's compiling a lot of different measurements, and I think some of these, so these are all measurements of a gap, each of these points. And then I think in order to place this on a temperature scale, they placed the temperature scale here according to this. And so this dashed line is coming from this assumption. But if you ignore that, you can still just focus on the data, and the data is measured with respect to the energy axis.
Right, right, okay.
Yeah.
So for a given sample, the correlation is greater at a closer distance, right? But does the correlation in absolute numbers decrease as you go to more doping, or does it stay the same? Like, is this plot for which of these three samples?
Oh, that's a good question. I would have to look back in the paper to see. I don't remember the details. I just know that the overall correlation, the global correlation, is off. But basically, this correlation has the same sign. I think it's roughly the same in all three samples. Yeah.
I'm just wondering how can the overall or average gap decrease
and the correlation increase at the same time.
Yeah, it's crazy,
being consistent.
Right? So the solution to that problem is that there's actually several types of oxygen dopants in the material, and that the throw these all up here. There are oxygen dopants that sit in the upper layer, which is what Kyle is imaging, so these little green guys here. And there are oxygen dopants that sit in the strontium oxide layer. And the ones in the strontium oxide layer actually have a stronger effect on the copper oxygen plane, whereas what was being imaged in that experiment were the dopants in the bismuth oxide layer, which are correlated. So even that doesn't completely solve the problem. So the final solution to the problem is that there's a third type of defect, which is a missing apical oxygen here. And the missing apical oxygen has a much larger local effect on the underlying copper region than either of those interstitial dopants. So my student, Ilya Zeltkovich, was able to image both the bismuth layer oxygens and the strontium layer oxygens and these apical oxygen vacancies. At the moment we imaged it, we didn't know what they were, but these apical oxygen vacancies actually have the opposite doping effect. So here's the interstitial oxygens that are in the bismuth oxide layer, which have a weak correlation. Here's the interstitial oxygens in the strontium oxide layer, and then here's the apical oxygen vacancies. And you can see that wherever we have apical oxygen vacancies, we have a very large gap. And an oxygen vacancy is the opposite of an oxygen. So an oxygen vacancy, instead of adding holes to the plane, it takes holes out of the plane. And so now we can see the expected correlation between what's effectively an electron donor, and the electron donor drives the gap higher. So if we put this all together here, we see that the number of apical oxygen vacancies here correlates with the local gap. So essentially, by donating electrons, we're moving left on the doping axis of the typical Cooper phase diagram, and that increases the gap. So this is specific to BISCO so far, but I think it's interesting and promising because it opens up the possibility of controlling the chemistry at the atomic scale and potentially raising TC. So this is some details of BISCO, but the next steps, which I think are interesting, there's several theory papers which suggest that by more optimal placement of dopants in the material, for example, coupling underdoped and underdoped and overdoped regions, one could achieve a more optimal TC, raise TC by 10 or 20% in some of these materials. So just to conclude that little section, I think that is one example of the power of STM. Once we can understand the local chemistry, then we can step towards controlling the local chemistry of the material. And actually, STM itself can, in some cases, already be used to control chemistry. STM can be used to manipulate single atoms and materials. And you can imagine applying a local voltage pulse and maybe shooting an oxygen out of the material. And we've done that in our lab in some other materials like band-aids, but not yet degrades.
Sorry.
Okay. Yeah, Sam.
Can you do STM on like thin films?
Yeah.
And so, does that in any way avoid some of the cleaning problems of like other cuprates besides BISCO, or is that?
Yeah. So that's a really good question. My first answer is yes, we can do STM on thin films. However, it hasn't been done in cuprates, and the problem is just that cuprates, oxides in general, are challenging to grow with MBE. So oxide is probably the most challenging type of MBE growth. And so there are a limited number of experts in the world who are really good at growing clean MBE oxides. And there are a limited number of STM experts in the world. And so far, there have been no successful marriages. So, yeah.
Also, for the BISCO you mentioned, is it single layer or bilayer?
This is so far bilayer BISCO.
So So I guess my question was, maybe this is too far in the future, but is there a physical reason why, for instance, you couldn't grow a thin film with, say, YVCO and measure it with STM?
Absolutely not.
Okay.
It should be done.
It could be done, but it just hasn't been done.
It hasn't been. There is an additional challenge that you'll find YVCO and LCO that you won't find VSCO, which is neither of them have that mirror plane. And so even if you grow a film, you could get a clean surface, but it might be a polar surface. In fact, it's likely to be a polar surface. And so it still might not be perfectly representative of the bulk. But Andrea Damascelli at UBC did a really nice experiment where he actually started with bulk YVCO and cleaved it in situ. And then he evaporated potassium slowly onto the surface. And the potassium serves to underdose the material. So the cleaved YVCO, it turned out, was polar, such that it was very far on the overdose side of the phase diagram. And by gradually adding potassium to the material, he was able to re-image the Fermi surface and see that the hole pockets were contracting as he added potassium. And so he was able to in situ dope the material back into the optimum dope range. So that works well for ARPES because it's not quite as surface sensitive as STM. I think Jan Pennick was starting to experiment with depositing potassium and doing STM on it and hasn't yet had success. Okay. So that was an example of how spatial resolution is useful in STM. And now I'm going to turn to momentum space resolution in STM. So I'm skipping ahead a bunch in the timeline. But as to motivate this sudden skip in the timeline, I'll show this sort of first inkling, as I know understands it. Dan, was this the first inkling that the gap had some anisotropy in it? So our fearless leader here obviously took this data, which gave us the first inkling that the gap was anisotropic in VSCO. And this motivates, of course, the search to understand the gap in anisotropy. Much of the work was done by ARPES, but now with STM we have an additional advantage that we can understand momentum space structure of the gap with a higher spatial resolution. So let's see how that looks. And some of the motivating questions are, how do we tell what's the pairing symmetry of the material? And then furthermore, how do we even tell where the pairing occurs? The pairing may or may not occur on the entire Fermi surface. So these are the kinds of questions we'd like to be able to address. Can be addressed with ARPES, but we'd like to be able to look local with these questions as well. So I showed you this tremendous amount of disorder in the material, this gap disorder. This is the example that I've shown before. I like to show it because I think it's fun, how disorder can help us. So I start out with a little story. This is me as an undergraduate rower. And incidentally, this is Sarah Demers, who's a physics professor at Yale now, so you must have been something in the water. But suppose you have some material that you don't know what it is, and you want to learn something about it. What would you do to learn about a completely unknown substance in front of you? And I asked my son this, and he said, taste it, and I said, wrong answer. So what you might do is, for this unknown substance, you might introduce some kind of a perturbation, so as an experimentalist. If you ever rowed, you know that if you win a race, the first thing you do after the race is you throw there's a little person sitting right here, it's not even a picture of the coxswain, and to celebrate the winning of the race, you throw the poor coxswain in the water. So there's our perturbation in the water, and if you introduce a perturbation in the water, you get some interference patterns. And by measuring the wavelength and the velocity of those interference patterns, you can back out things like the density of the surface tension and other important properties of the water. So basically, by introducing junk into your material or disorder into your material, you can learn really interesting physical properties of the material. So likewise, VSCO, we introduce some site defects or we put some oxygen disorder in, and we can get these beautiful interference patterns. And these interference patterns are then actually going to tell us about the electron waves in the material as opposed to the water waves here. So this is known as quasi-particle interference. And the first QPI, quasi-particle interference, this doesn't help me to point at the screen here, was actually done by Cromulitz and Eigler on a simple metal This, I believe, was a copper surface with some defects on it. Here's some immediate follow-up work on gold surface. And you can see, again, these beautiful interference patterns. These are electron waves scattering off of defects in the material. And these measurements were static measurements. But let me explain, okay, here comes the advertised hike, how you can actually learn something about the energy dependence of the material. So, for example, this is a contour map. And this is a lovely hike for anybody who has some extra time to bag a couple of 14ers. And it's actually not a steep trail. It's very doable for even mere mortals like me who don't have any idea how to climb officially with ropes or anything. So this is a contour map, but I show this example because I'm going to try to take your intuition about how a contour map works and turn it into a Brillouin zone. So let's suppose that instead of x and y, we have kx and ky, and that each of these contours, which are actually altitude contours, we're going to pretend that they're contours of constant energy in our Brillouin zone. And now if we introduce some junk in our material, some perturbation, then we can get elastic scattering between any points that are on the same contour of constant energy. And in particular, if we have sort of quasi-parallel contours here at the same energy, then we're going to have a lot of scattering between these quasi-parallel contours. And so we'll have a standing wave set up at a wave vector corresponding to the distance between those contours. And the power spectrum of the scattering is going to be proportional to whatever perturbing potential we have times the density of initial states times the density of final states. And it's this factor here which tells us that parallel sections are going to give us a high power spectrum of scattering in this particular wave vector Q. And also, if we have large flat regions, we can get a high scattering. So regions where the contours are far apart will contribute to this. Now, in general, we don't know what this is. And so in general, this could dramatically complicate our measurement of power spectrum of scattering. But in practice, this seems to not be so significant. And this here allows us to get a lot of information about the raw density of states as a function of energy and momentum.
Sorry, when you say that turns out to not be significant, how is that determined? Are you going to talk about
by comparison to ARPAS, essentially. So we know the Fermi surface, and we know the gap magnitude from our tests. And so the first thing we did when we employed this technique to look at cube rates was to compare to our PES measurement that already existed. So let me come back to that. So there's some real theory here. And you can peruse in more detail in your spare time. But there are cross terms. Theorists yell at me because I never include the cross terms. Experimentally, we don't see the cross terms. That's the summary of that. So let's look at the simplified Brillouin zone of cube rate. Here's the Hall pockets, the electron pockets, the Fermi surface in the normal state. Let's turn on the superconducting. Let me just add more contours. So now these are down contours, lower altitude contours. These are higher altitude contours. And now let's turn on the superconducting gap. When we turn on the superconducting gap, which has a zero, right, this node here, and then increases away from the node, what happens is that, let me go back and forth between these two, these contours come together and become bananas. So we have a kind of a Dirac point at each of these nodes, but it's a banana-shaped Dirac point. So it's like I took this piece of paper, just for those of you who would be three-dimensional visualization. So what's going on here is you take this Dirac point, you kind of fold it into a banana, and that's what you're seeing here, is these contours of that banana. And I was very pleased in grad school to be able to get the word banana into a science paper. Okay, so here's our contours. Let's just build this up one at a time so we can see what's going on. The bananas are growing as the energy is rising away from this Dirac point. And now this density of states is going to be highest at the ends of these bananas, because that's where there are large flat regions in our contour maps. So we're going to have a lot of scattering to and from these flat regions. And so our dominant power spectrum is going to be the wave vectors connecting this octet of banana bananas. Yeah?
So at what energy from the graph nodes do you have these event points assigned to these red dots?
Yeah, so here's the direct point, this is zero. And I was just building it up one at a time, so there's the 10 millielectron volt contour. So this is a tight binding parameterization of optimum and dope disco. The tight binding parameterization due to Mike Norman based on Tomazano data, I think. Is that getting the information?
Yeah, exactly. Thanks. So it's about 40
milli. Yeah. This is for optimal doped disco.
Sorry, there are banana tips at any bias voltage, right?
Exactly. Yeah, so for every bias voltage, there's a different set of banana tips. So I didn't, so I guess I should have drawn red circles moving outwards as the bananas grew. So imagine some red circles at the end of those bananas, imagine some more red circles, imagine some more red circles. Ah, here, I finally got motivated and drew the red circles. Sorry. I can put the red circles on for the online post. Yeah.
Right, so I missed the.
The delta and the effort difference.
This is great. There's a normal state. Okay, and you turn on the superconducting gap. And so what happens is that a gap does not open here, so this is a Dirac point, but a gap starts to open here. And because the particles and the holes are mixed, you can think of the contour of constant energy now as surrounding the Dirac point. So you have a banana-shaped Dirac point going up. So if you were to plot the, if you were to try to make some kind of a structure, origami and bananas, great. So here's your Dirac going up, and here's your Dirac going down, right? And I'm just plotting the contours, which are slices going up here. Is that?
It's banana because of the anisotropy.
Delta.
It's the curvature of the Fermi surface.
It's the curvature of the Fermi surface that makes it a banana. If the Fermi surface were a straight line, and if the Fermi velocity were the same in the x and y direction, then it would just be a Dirac point. But it's so the difference in Fermi velocity along x and y is what squishes it, and then the curvature is what bends it. So I'm a very simple-minded experimentalist. I think this origami and bananas will all go for me. Okay. So this is all of the contours displayed simultaneously, and then to try to clarify that, I just tried to build up the contours one layer at a time, because it's kind of hard to see all together. So this is a particular set of four bananas at 10, 20, 30, and 40. And at 40 millielectron volts, then the dominant scattering is going to be between these particular sets of banana tips. And this technique is much more general than just BISCO. This technique can be applied to any material that has a nice, that basically works well in two-dimensional materials, material surface state. But anytime you have quasi-parallel segments where you have a lot of density of states, or you have flat regions where you have a lot of density of states, then you're going to have dominant scattering between certain points in the Riemann zone. And when you have dominant scattering, then it's easy to kind of invert the boundaries. But yeah.
What temperature is this?
What temperature? This is below superconducting temperature. So you can think of it as zero. So it's just a tight binding approximation to the. Okay, so what we want is to understand the K-space structure, the Fermi surface, the Riemann zone. So we'd like to get our hands on these blue curves, the location and momentum space of the blue curves, and also the energy of the gap along the blue curve. And what we know qualitatively is that we're going to have scattering between pairs of K1 and K2, and that's going to give us a Q which joins them. But we're going to have lots of pairwise scatterings, so we're going to have that pair, that pair, that pair, that pair, that pair, and that pair. So we get this whole, we should have a whole set of dominant scattering vectors corresponding to different pairwise interference terms there. Does that make sense so far?
Yes, but in your right panel, all these endpoints of the arrows just still resemble the same geometry as you have. I mean, this Q6 and Q3 should on the same horizontal, and Q7 and Q2 should also on the same horizontal.
Yes, there. This is now. I need to make this fourfold rotation symmetric. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. Absolutely. I just drew one at a time. So there you go. Symmetrize them. You end up with something like this. Is that the question you're asking?
Yeah.
Okay. Right. So now, if you have a real space field of view with lots of scatterings in it, then the scattering, if you Fourier transform it, the wave vectors that you would expect in the Fourier transform of your real space image would correspond to the 7 that I just showed plus their fourfold symmetry. And now we get to the question of how they vary with energy. So again, this is a cartoon. Let's start with zero energy, and let's look at this particular scattering vector, which we like to call Q1. And now rival labs, this is a kind of annoying thing, rival labs, like for example, Davis and Yazdani lab, they like to just rename all of their Qs just to kind of piss each other off. So this is this is Q1 in Davis language. So, although you have to come up with a new name for it, otherwise you can't publish it in the one-word journal. So, let's look at Q1. At zero energy, Q1 is just connecting the Dirac nodes. So at zero energy, let's plot a wave vector there. And then now, as I increase the energy, at some energy, this Q is getting a little bit shorter. So I increase the energy, and Q is getting shorter. As I increase the energy more, I'm moving farther away from the nodes, and Q is getting shorter. And so I should end up with some kind of dispersion that looks like this. And now, Andrew, you look like you want to ask a question.
Can I ask what Q1 is exactly? So originally it was distance between diagonal points. If you look at the picture on
it's along the copper oxide bond direction.
Between nearest and
horizontal.
The nearest boundary.
From upper left to
yes,
right.
Between
upper
nearest
left
and
to upper right. Okay.
It's this
okay.
One right here.
Yeah, good. Thanks.
So
thanks,
if
thanks.
Okay. So as I increase the energy, it's getting shorter. So I'm moving out away from the node, meaning the gap energy is increasing, and I'm moving away from the node, meaning the frame surface is getting closer together, and so that Q is getting shorter. So my dispersion is downwards for Q1. Okay, so let's look at a different one, just for an example, they go the other direction. Q7 is now an intra-banana scattering. There's a phrase for you. So the intra-banana scattering is non-existent at zero. So there's not really anything we can measure there, but just put the point there for reference. But as we go up in energy, the banana grows, and the intra-banana scattering increases. Okay? So we have examples now of how these Qs can disperse in different directions. And now, this is all a cartoon, but we can actually measure those Qs. And once we measure the Qs, we can measure this full set of Qs, then, just looking back, should have had this slide fit here. Once we measure this set of Qs, then we just have a simple linear algebra problem to get back to the case. And then we will have mapped out the symmetry of the gap on the curved surface. And in fact, it's an over-constrained linear algebra problem because we have 7 measurements here. And because of the symmetry of the problem, we have only two coordinates, the kx and the ky coordinate of a particular point on the frame surface.
So it's a consistency check on the octet.
Exactly, yeah.
So I can distinguish both the direction of the q and the magnitude or just the magnitude?
There's no sign on the q, but we know what direction it's pointing in space. Is that your question?
In the experiment, I'm wondering, can you distinguish the direction or just the
Let me show you the data, and maybe it's clear, and if it's not clear, then I'll try to make it more clear. So here's the topography at FISCO. This is data that was, a lot of this data was taken by Kyle McElroy as a graduate student who did this lab some time ago. So here's a map of the density of states at an energy minus 40. So I'm actually, the way I'm displaying this energy, I'm starting at the tips of the largest bananas and then can go in towards the Dirac node. So this is the density of states in real space. And now, just Fourier transform the density of states. And so now this is the power spectrum. Especially the square root of the power spectrum. And this is that power spectrum that should be equal to u of q times density of initial states times density of final states. So as I scan up in energy here, I can see in real space that there's some structure developing. It looks sort of periodic along this direction and this direction. And I can also see that some stuff is happening in Fourier space here, which is a little easier to quantify. There's definitely some structure developing in Fourier space. Now you can see there's lots of peaks, and those peaks are moving, dispersing. And if I label each data point according to the Q that it corresponds to. So you were asking, can you determine a direction and a magnitude? Well, this is a magnitude, and then you know an angle gives you a direction. There's no sign associated with the Q vector because it's just a difference between two K states. But it does have a magnitude and a direction. Does that answer your question? Yeah. But admittedly, I threw out the direction information in making this plot because I couldn't very well plot them. Then I would have a three-dimensional plot, and I can't do that properly.
So are you using a separate vessel to get this map for GMAP or other, like, fixing the distance? So is this analysis has different features if you use different map or same?
Yes, so this analysis is quantitatively the same in VSCO if you use the raw density of states, which is what I've shown, or if you use the Z-map, it does not change. In some materials, like NACCOC, the signal to noise is not high enough to see it unless you use the Z-map. Yeah, yeah.
So the QBI data you showed us are symmetrized?
Excuse
me? Are they symmetrized, the data?
What I showed was not symmetrized, but it would look the same if it were symmetrized. It increases the noise a little bit if it's symmetrized, but I try not to do that unless I have to because I like to show raw data when I can. So here's that Q1, which is dispersing down, or the Q7, which is dispersing up, and all the other Qs, which go in different directions. And then Kyle and I were able to invert this and compare to ARPES measured Fermi surface and show that the Fermi surface that we extract from the QPI lies in good agreement with the ARPES Fermi surface. I think I left out the gap information. The gap information is in reasonable but not perfect agreement with ARPES. So I think within error bars, it's reasonably good, but there's probably some more work we could do to totally understand that structure factor. Did that answer your question from before, Sam? I forgot what your question was.
It was about this scattering function V of Q.
Yeah.
Which I guess is it depends on the defects, the nature of the defect scattering, right?
Exactly. Yeah, it's got to depend on the nature of the defects. And what it probably does is it controls the amplitude, and it may bear some responsibility for the fact that But you notice ARPANET has a nice Fermi surface, and STM is missing some chunks of our Fermi surface. So there's a bunch of potential reasons why we're missing chunks of the Fermi surface. One might be the AQ. One might be just the matrix elements to tunnel between the tip and the sample. And then there's a third reason, which I think actually has to do with the physics of the problem, that we're not actually seeing a Fermi surface outside of the antiferromagnetic Brillouin zone. So the missing Fermi surface out here is actually an interesting piece of physics that I'll come back to.
Sorry, when you say missing Fermi surface, what do you mean? Like,
I mean, we don't see any QPI beyond that point, beyond those Ks.
Or the QPI is broad, like at the 40 MeV image you showed, like there was definitely some scattering away from P equals zero, right? It was just incoherence.
It never gets to a wave vector that corresponds to the edge of the Brillouin zone. So it exists at an energy that you would think would correspond to the edge of the Brillouin zone, but it doesn't get there. I have a better plot at some later point. Yeah.
I want to ask about the missing Fermi surface at low energy, very close to the crack point.
Mm-hmm.
I remember the previous slide when you showed the QPI. QPI seems to exist down to 5 milli electron volts.
Yeah.
And but looking from the Brillouin zone, a pretty large region near the crack point seems to be missing.
Yeah, that's the discrepancy between ARPANET and STM. So the shape of the gap at the node is different from this STM. And I think some of it has to do with broadening, and Dan has done a terrible job taking care of that. And some of it has to do, some of it is intrinsic broadening, and some of it is stupid experimental broadening, because the way we do this with a lock-in amplifier, we're always modulating the voltage around some central voltage. And if you think about this direct shape cone, this banana direct cone here, if you modulate, if you use your lock-in amplifier and modulate the energy, because the density of states is increasing so fast, when you modulate, you're getting an uneven average, and you're getting more of the higher density of states. And so that it is an experimental artifact, which messes with that even more as well. Okay, so QPI is great. It allows STM to be a momentum space tool as well as a real space tool. And then one of the really cool things that Eric Hudson did to extend this was to look at local PPI, essentially. All right. So you might expect that if the doping is varying inside the material, as we showed in the first part of the talk, then the band structure itself could be varying inside the material. Or at the very least, the filling should be varying on the nanoscale inside the material. So if you believe the dopants are responsible for that disorder, then you also believe that this whole pocket is changing size locally on a several nanometer length scale. And this idea at first met with a tremendous resistance, but it's not so crazy, because we're all used to band bending at semiconductor surfaces, which can happen over very short length scales. And also, just mathematically, this is a wave vector, which means there's a particular wavelength associated with it, and that wavelength is allowed to change on a length scale comparable to itself. So this wave vector corresponds to a wavelength on order a couple nanometers. And so there's no reason why this wave vector can't change on the nanometer scale in the material. So what Eric Hudson did is he effectively Fourier transformed individual nanoscale patches of material to extract a local nesting vector here. In each nanoscale patch of material. And he plotted the local nesting vector for individual patches versus the local pseudogap energy in the material. And so he was able to find that within a single material, here, there's a beautiful correlation between the local wave vector and the local pseudo gap. So let's figure out if this sign of this correlation makes sense. Here's our roadmap here. As we increase the hole doping, that means we're increasing the size of this pocket. So we're shortening this wave vector. So as we increase the hole doping, this wave vector goes down. And furthermore, as we increase the hole doping, the pseudo gap goes down. So that means that increasing the hole doping sends both that wave vector and the pseudo gap in the same direction, which means the pseudo gap and that wave vector should be correlated to each other. And in fact, they are.
So I thought that wave vector couldn't be extracted from QPI. Isn't that what you just told me a minute ago?
Yeah, I have sloppily drawn this, actually. So when Eric wrote this paper, he thought that it was this wave vector. In fact, it's the banana tip wave vector. But they differ by only a few percent. Yeah.
And the 2D gap has been determined as what?
From an individual point spectrum. Just looking at the distance between the Fermi level and some peak.
Yeah.
So this is a really strong argument that there is dramatic local doping variation in the material, and that we understand the direction, we understand that it controls the pseudo gap, and that again, it's evidence that there's this knob that's just there waiting to be turned by some brilliant chemists or by MBE and STM in combination. Yeah.
Good question. If you convert the picture on the right into the picture on the left, how much is the variation in terms of doping? You showed how the measurements of Fermi surface effect or tip of banana.
Mm-hmm.
If you convert it into the picture of doping, how much is basically doping variation?
Well, within a single sample here, so let's take this optimally doped sample in orange, and we're going from about 20 to 40. So this roadmap here is for double layer visco, so our scale is a little bit off, but it's a 50% variation in the pseudo gap here, and a 50% variation in the pseudo gap is like 5% of doping or something. It's quite a lot.
Actually, I thought it's a lot more than 5%.
It looks like the bottom
10%.
Yeah. So you could probably model, I know that Belotsky and somebody have just an old, really simple paper in which they modeled, does this make sense? You know, if you throw dopants in randomly, are you going to get this variation of doping? Ivar Martin Belotsky, that's what it is. It's a physicist even some time ago. And it was plausible. I mean, it is a very simple. Even an experimentalist could do the calculation, but they did it first. So. Okay. So again, showing the power of STM now is a local momentum space measurement and reinforcing that chemistry is important and that I think it's kind of the future is to be able to control this chemistry on the length scale. Just a word on spatial versus momentum resolution. The bigger your real space map, the better your Q-space resolution. So if you have a big real space map here gives you really fine resolution in Q-space. On the other hand, really high resolution in real space gives you access to more of the Grewal zone. And for global properties, this is relevant, but many of the properties that we're interested in, like this nanoscale variation of the Fermi surface, we're limited not by how much data we can take, but we're limited by the size of the patch over which the data is homogeneous. So even though we can draw this kind of glorious figure and have 600 angstrom and say our Q-space resolution is really excellent, in reality, in cuprates, the doping causes so much variation, our Q-space resolution is generally not this good. But it's a pure mathematical limitation. So you pick your Q-space resolution that you want, you choose your real space size, etc. Okay, I got like 10 minutes left, and I'm gonna start in on a new segment here.
Okay, can I just ask about your actual Q-space resolution then?
Yeah.
I mean, how good can you get it in a real experiment on visco?
Oh, it's limited by the patch size, 3 nanometers, so it's 2 pi over 3 nanometers.
Which is the same.
Yeah, I don't think in the same language as you.
Okay. What fraction of the zone is that?
It's like 10% of the zone. Yeah.
This is for local measurement of the QPI or?
Yeah, for local QPI.
For global, it can be much bigger. No, the field of view can be much bigger.
For global, yeah. So you can get a sample average with much better resolution than that. But the physics is going on in that length scale. So, I mean, I would argue that ARPES is averaging over that anyhow.
In a different way.
Yeah. In a different way, yeah. I mean, they're obviously complementary techniques. So we need ARPES, we need STM. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, second question. There are 5 minutes left, so either you prefer to go to the next subject or we can stop now and ask for questions.
We can do that. This section is actually pretty short. So, but I'm happy to take more questions. I really don't want to cut anyone off. Yeah, we want to take a student question first. Yeah.
So in the previous local measurement of QPI architecture, how big do you take the size of the local Fourier transformation?
excuse me. So that's a technical question. It's what he actually did is slightly different. The details of the analysis are slightly different than the way I simplified it to explain it. So what he actually did is he looked at the modulation in real space, and he used a local maximum finder to put to find, just a, like an algorithmic finder of local maximum, to find all the crests of the modulation that corresponds to that near antinodal nesting vector. So, let's see, what does it say? So there's an energy, for example, where you can see this modulation pretty strongly. This particular modulation, as you can see strongly here, corresponds to that near antinodal nesting vector. And so he found he could put local maxima on each crest here, and at each, then he did a Voronoi analysis. So he called each point the center of a cell of the modulation, and then he took the square root of that and called it a wavelength.
Could you go forward to the slides?
It's a technical detail. Maybe I can. I think it's boring. Can I explain it to you afterwards so we can just do? I'm sorry. It's because there's not really any physics there. It's just a technical detail.
Oh, I was wondering whether by changing the size of my local domain for Fourier transformation, you can see the size difference.
You just smear it out. As you increase the size, you smear out the effect.
Do you have estimates at which length scale you can see the average?
Well, the best you can do is the wavelength of the modulation. And so he did this special way of getting exactly the limit, the wavelength of the modulation.
And it corresponds to the U plus 3, you see the emitting.
Yeah, exactly. It corresponds to that 2 or 3 nanometer scale. Okay, I'm sorry, I misunderstood your question. I thought you were asking a boring question, but you were asking a good question. But it's not that I thought your question was boring, it's that I thought the answer was boring. Yeah, do you still have a question? Okay. You're afraid I'm going to tell you you're boring, too? It was my interpretation of the question that was boring. Okay, another thing that STM is good for is vortex imaging, and I will stop right at 12:30 even if I'm not having this session, because I'm hungry too. So, just to pay historical homage, vortices were first imaged in Nyokudai selenide back in 1989, just a few years after STM was invented, and here's an image of the vortex lattice Nyokudai selenide. So what exactly is this? This is the density of states at the Fermi limit. And why does that give us a map of the vortex lattice? Well, there's this beautiful paper by Karoly Dejean-Ratrikhan, which solves for the energy levels of the vortex pore state and finds that they should have energies of the bulk gap squared over the Fermi energy. But if you actually throw energies in there for a typical conventional superconductor, you've got a Fermi energy on order of EV, then you've got a bulk gap on order of milli electron volts, and so your energy of your core states is effectively at the Fermi level. That's an almost unresolvable energy. And so inside a vortex, so far from a vortex, you'll see a nice superconducting gap spectrum. And inside a vortex, you'll see a peak which appears to be at the Fermi level. So by imaging the density of states at this energy, you can distinguish between spectra far from vortices and spectra in the center of vortices. And this is really just a particle in a box problem. It's like you've got a normal electron, it's stuck inside a vortex core. Everywhere outside of the vortices, you've got pairing potential. Inside the vortex, superconductivity is destroyed, and so you've got these normal state electrons which are stuck there. You solve the particle in a box, and you get those states.
What determines that line shape there? The tough curve with the dip and the...
Oh, there's details. So this is a reasonably readable paper. It solves the global voltage equations to figure out. When I say reasonably readable, I meant I looked at it and I thought, I could read that if I spent another hour on it, and then I didn't. excuse me. So, and then there's some follow-up papers. And then this peak in practice, it does interesting things. As you get away from the core, it starts to split a little bit. And there's, I'm sorry, I don't have the details at my fingertips. The interesting point, though, is now for cuprates. If you just look at this formula, for cuprates, the density is very low. The Fermi level is very small, and the gap is quite large. So you could expect for cuprates, you might now be able to resolve those states individually. And indeed, in YBCO, first, this nice work by Jason Fisher's group, Yvonne Maggio-April, saw vortex core states in YBCO, plus or minus 5 millielectron volts, and then Shu-Heng Pan, the Davis group, saw vortex core states in BISCO, plus or minus 7 millielectron volts. And in the last minute, I'll just give you a flash of what you can do with vortices. It's interesting. Here's, for example, a measurement of vortex pinning. Here's a twin boundary in YBCO with vortex lattice on both sides. And by reducing the field, the vortices were able to flee the sample on one side of the twin boundary, but they got stuck in the sample on the other side of the twin boundary. And so this allows you to estimate the pinning force corresponding to the twin boundary in the material. So this is something that's of interest to engineers, of course. If we want to build better superconducting devices, we need to pin our vortices in place. we had done some work looking at vortex pinning in iron-based superconductors, and it's kind of off topic, so I'll skip that. And I'll just leave you with this, that vortices, because they destroy the superconducting state, they serve as a really nice nanoscale window into the normal state of a superconductor, or whatever it is when you destroy a magnetic field. That you can't globally destroy a magnetic field very easily in these materials because you need like 80 Tesla or 100 Tesla, but a vortex gives you a way to locally destroy the field, and if you have this local tool of STM, you can actually see what's in there. So, I didn't get through nearly as much material as I thought, but it was fun. Thanks for all your questions. Okay. Lunch?
Right.
Are there more questions
there? Are there more questions? There will be a question and answer session after your last talk.
Okay. That's after, are we doing it on Thursday?
We'll do it on Thursday.
Okay.
We'll decide when, but we'll do it on Thursday, not on Friday.
Okay, good. Thanks.
So, thanks again.
就是那个电脑机房里面，就是把这个卡在那个就是在那儿有个小显示器，然后滑一下那个，然后去，就printer吗？
就是printer，滑一下那个。
对，